Good evening. We gather here on one of the holiest nights on our Christian calendar as we continue our journey with Jesus towards the hope of Easter morning. But before we get there, we take some time to be here, reflecting on the familiar yet challenging events and uncertainty of Maundy Thursday. Maundy Thursday is the first of 3 days of solemn remembrance of the events of Holy Week, with Good Friday and Holy Saturday to follow. Now, the word Maundy comes from the Latin mandatum, which means mandate or commandment. As recorded in John's Gospel, which we'll hear this evening, before eating their last supper together, Jesus washed the feet of his disciples and then gave them a new commandment, to love one another as he had loved them. This is also the night that Jesus broke bread with his disciples and instructed them to continue to do so in his name, in remembrance of him. So tonight we will break bread and share that meal together, in remembrance of the one who taught us to love and serve in his name, extravagantly and unconditionally. We will also experience the service of Tenebrae, led by our deacons, a dramatic reading of the scriptures that detail the events of Jesus' final hours on earth, with music and time for reflection interspersed. Now, the story of Jesus' journey to the cross is traditionally called the Passion of Jesus, and this comes from yet another Latin word, patior, which means to suffer, to bear, to endure. And on this Maundy Thursday evening, we hold all those in our world and our community who are enduring suffering at this time. And tonight we pray for two in our own community, for Don and Caroline. Don suffered a bleed in his brain overnight and is now in Elliott Hospital awaiting results of tests for tomorrow. So we hold Carol and Don in our prayers in their uncertainty and suffering this evening, and may they feel our presence with them tonight. They were so sad not to be here. Maundy Thursday is a service they always attended and loved. So we hold them in our love and prayer, as we know God does as well. Now, those final hours that Jesus spent with his disciples and without them were filled with betrayal, denial, and desertion, and great pain and suffering. But those hours were also filled with great love and sacrifice. This is a story that we will walk into this evening together and experience together in the loving presence of our God. Let us continue now in the spirit of worship.
Will you please rise as you are able in either body or spirit and join me in your bulletin for our call to worship this evening. We are Jesus' disciples, following him even as he moves towards the cross.
As he kneels to wash the dust from the feet of his friends, as he breaks bread and pours the cup one last time,
we are Jesus' disciples, longing to be faithful as the night grows dark.
As betrayers loom, as the powers that oppose the way of Christ press in around us,
we are Jesus' disciples, struggling to love and forgive as Jesus did.
As he broke bread with those who would abandon him, as he forgave those who turned against him,
we are Jesus' disciples, loving mercy, acting justly, walking humbly in his footsteps.
We are Jesus' disciples, gathered here to worship our God, our Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer. Amen.
Thank you.
seated. I invite you to receive our prayer of invocation this evening. Dear God, in this holiest week, we truly are in a liminal space, a transitional space, a time in between what was and what will be. We are caught in the tension between light and shadow, death and resurrection. You spoke the world into being. You illuminated the universe by your very speech, then filled the void with life. Indeed, you have filled the abyss of darkness and death with new life and new creation. We look to you in the space between this world and your world, longing for the fulfillment of your word in the work of the Holy Spirit and the reign of Christ. We feel your comforting presence with us now, O God, as we gather to walk with Jesus in his final hours, knowing that he too is with us always. Amen.
The Lenten process of self-examination, of holding our lives before God, is in many ways like holding up a mirror to bring our own attention to the ways in which we fall short of being a reflection of Christ in our world. It's an act of complete trust and vulnerability. So on the night that Jesus offered himself up for us, we ask ourselves, would we have the courage to do the same? Let's join together now in our litany of confession. Surely not us, Lord, surely not.
Surely we are not the ones who will betray you.
It's someone else who denies knowing you.
Someone else who uses you for their own gain.
Someone else who wants to control you.
Surely not us.
For the times we deny our faults.
For the times we point fingers to cover up our own wrong.
For the times we think of ourselves more highly than we ought. For the times we have betrayed you with our words.
Speaking thoughtlessly, hurting someone to get a laugh.
Denying that your call extends to every part of our lives.
Forgive us.
For the times we have betrayed you with our actions.
Living as if you are confined to this sanctuary.
Walking away from those in need, literally and politically. For the times we have betrayed you with our hearts.
Putting you far down our priority list.
Longing for our way to be your way.
Forgive us.
Surely not us, Lord.
Yet you have said it is so.
This truth hurts us, O God, and yet we believe.
We believe that you have the power to transform us.
We believe that your grace is enough. We believe that you are the way, the life, and the truth.
And this truth sets us free.
Amen.
Hear the word of God from the Gospel of John. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. He then poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and wipe them off with a towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" And Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I'm doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you shall have no share with me." Simon Peter said, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." After he washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you as an example that you should do as I have done to you. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Here ends our reading.
There's something missing from the traditional Maundy Thursday passage that we just read from the Gospel of John. Between the foot washing and Jesus' command to love one another as I have loved you, something pivotal to the Passion story has occurred. Judas has left the room. Possibly still clutching the bread that Jesus had handed him as a way of identifying him as his betrayer, before telling him to do quickly what you are going to do. Now, on this night, when one disciple betrays Jesus and another denies even knowing him, we tend to have much more sympathy for the denier. Peter, who continually misunderstood or refused to hear Jesus' assertion that as their master and teacher, he had come to serve rather than to be served. Peter, whom John's gospel identifies as the disciple who pulls out a sword and cuts off the ear of one of the guards who came to arrest him. Peter, who said he had never met the disgraced Galilean when he was confronted not once but three times as he was waiting outside that room where Jesus had been led to be flogged. And Peter, who along with all the disciples deserted Jesus in his darkest hour and was nowhere near the cross when he breathed his last. Now, Peter was confused. He was angry. He was impulsive. He was afraid. And he was powerless to prevent the events of that evening from spiraling forward. Peter was just doing what any one of us would likely do. If we had to choose between standing up for what we believe and living to see another day. The fight or flight or freeze impulse is real in all of us. And on that night, Peter managed to do all three. But while Peter deserted and denied Jesus, he didn't betray him in the way that Judas did, trading his teacher's life for 30 pieces of silver and handing him over to the authorities with a kiss. Judas left the room before Jesus gave the disciples that new commandment, to love one another as he had loved them. But if Judas had been there, this command likely would have further cemented his perception of Jesus all the more. Jesus was not the one that he and his people had been waiting for after all. In the beginning, he seemed like the one, with his talk of bringing down the powerful and lifting up the lowly, with his focus on justice for the poor and the oppressed and the lost and the forgotten. He said all the right things and spoke against the same institutions and the same people that Judas held in disdain. The Roman Empire, the corrupt religious leaders, the ordinary citizens who did nothing and said nothing when empire and apathy swept away their neighbors. Jesus seemingly was fighting the same fight that Judas was. He seemingly had the same enemies. And he seemingly longed for the same outcome, to set their people free, even if it took clubs and swords and a lot of spilled blood to do so. But then came talk of loving one's enemies and forgiving one's persecutors and turning the other cheek when on the receiving end of a violent slap. There was talk of some future heavenly kingdom where God would reign and all would be made right. But there was little talk of justice right there in the present. And there was Jesus' continued insistence that he was destined to die at the hands of the authorities, leaving the disciples without a leader and no better off than when they began. Now, it's unlikely that Judas participated in the palm parade that the others had orchestrated when they arrived in Jerusalem for the Passover. His disappointment and regret and anger were likely already driving him to do something to stop this false Messiah, to stop this movement from going any further. Especially after Jesus pulled that little stunt in the temple, turning over the tables of the money changers. While Judas likely thought it was good to see this man of peace finally expressing a bit of rage against the machine, the timing was not right. The movement was still too small, and causing a disturbance during Passover when thousands of people had descended upon the city would have put them too prominently on Rome's radar and may have resulted in all of them being snuffed out before they even lit the flame of revolution. So on the occasion of that Last Supper, Judas did what he may have thought was best for them all. It could even be said that Judas was as confused and angry and impulsive and afraid and as powerless to prevent the events of that evening from spiraling forward just as Peter was. Now, all of this is, of course, speculation. The gospel accounts of Judas's free will agency and motivation in that moment are incomplete and inconclusive and, in some cases, contradictory. Some say he was driven by greed. Some say the devil had entered his heart. Some say he was merely a cog in the wheel that God used to make the resulting resurrection possible. And outside of the Gospels, it's been said that Judas may not have realized that his betrayal would result in Jesus' death, that he thought he would simply be held for causing a disturbance and released after the Passover celebration, when things calmed down and the threat against them had subsided. But if we isolate the man from these assumptions and the traditions and the accusations that have been heaped upon him, we'll likely find someone who is very much like us. Someone who felt compelled to fight against the evil in the world, but didn't know how to do so without resorting to evil himself. An eye for an eye. Someone who had heard God's call to love thy neighbor, but struggled to live into it in the real world, where neighbors are sometimes and often very hard to love. Someone who is longing for a savior to fix all that is broken in our world and in our hearts. But when we are swimming in the brokenness, it's so hard to tell who might be throwing us a lifeline and who might be dragging us under further still. So on that fateful night, Jesus gave his disciples a new commandment: to love one another as he loved them. And the word used for love here is the Greek verb agapao, which means to provide or exhibit love through action. Jesus called it a new commandment, but the call to live into love was something the disciples had heard him speak about over and over. And he did it again on that night, knowing that in a few hours' time, all of them would choose to live into fear instead. So the Maundy Thursday story doesn't really leave us on a hopeful note. The hope of the resurrection is still to come on Easter morning. On this night, we are left in our uncertainty and in our grief. And hopefully we will find some connection with Peter and Judas and all of the 12 who, like us, each grieved in their own way. Judas grieved the loss of the hope and trust that he had placed in Jesus as Messiah, and he expressed this grief by turning him in, giving into his anger and bargaining for a future for their movement. Peter grieved the loss of hope and trust he'd placed in Jesus by running away and falling into denial and hiding in despair. And when we're grieving, we may each respond in our own way. And in our grief, it can be hard to practice that agapao love, the love that calls us to resist whatever emotion we're feeling in that moment and to love one another through our actions, just as Jesus loved us all the way to the cross. Now, the good news that Jesus leaves us with on this Maundy Thursday evening is that there is no judgment and no shame in our struggle or our failure to love in this way, especially when we're grieving. With his dying breath, Jesus said, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they're doing." And given what we know about Jesus, we know this call for forgiveness applied to Judas just as it applied to Peter and to Pilate and to the mob shouting at him, and all who brought him to the cross. Now, there are many ways that we deny and betray Jesus in our own time, in our own world, in our own hearts. What a gift Jesus has given us in the love that he showed us on this night, in the grace he offered in his darkest hour, in the hope he gave us on Easter morning. In retelling the story, we are not there yet, but we will be in just a few days' time. And we know in our hearts that we are already there on this side of the resurrection. And thanks be to God, and amen. Friends, tonight we gather at this table and remember that on Jesus' last night here on earth, he gathered with his disciples and shared in an ordinary meal that had extraordinary implications.
For at this table, Jesus broke bread with one who betrayed him, with one who denied him, and with those who fled from him in his time of need.
Now, it would not have been God's table if they hadn't all been gathered around it together, the betrayer and the friend, the power-hungry and the justice-seeker, the faithful and the fickle.
When Jesus poured the cup and the bread was broken, when everyone could eat, the outcast and the beloved, the arrogant and the gracious, the wrongdoer and the wrongly done by, the table became a foretaste of love made real, and of a world made whole.
The promise here is that when we are all together, when we tell this story and give this blessing, when we break the bread and pour the cup, we will experience a foretaste of that love made real, of our world made whole.
Friends, will you join me in your bulletin for our call to communion? God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give thanks to God Most High.
It is right to give God thanks and praise. And let us pray. Gracious God, we gather as followers of Jesus to reflect upon the life that ended on the cross. We recognize in ourselves the strengths and weaknesses of his disciples. And yet, gathering with these imperfect friends at this last meal, Jesus extended the bread and cup to each. And we are humbled, honored, and inspired by the deep love Christ brought to the world. And we take seriously the calling to be the body of Christ today. We ask that you grant us the vision to see the world as you see it. Grant us the courage to see this night through. And grant us the comfort of knowing that you are with us now and always. Amen. And on that night when Jesus gathered with his friends in that upper room, that night where he was betrayed and denied and deserted, he still shared a meal with all of them. And when it came time to the end of that meal, he picked up the bread on the table and he broke it and he blessed it and he said, "This is my body, which has been broken for all of you. Whenever you eat of this, remember me."
And likewise, after they had eaten, he took a cup and he blessed it and he said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for you. Take it and drink it, and whenever you do that, do it in remembrance of me."
Holy One, now that the hour has come, send your spirit upon these gifts of the bread and the cup. As you hold the bread in your gentleness, break it, give it to us, feed us with your compassion, that we might be made whole, and in our healing become servants to a shattered world. As you take the cup in your own care, fill it with your tears of hope, so we might carry this gift to all who long for your presence. Amen. Tonight we will receive communion by intinction, so we'll be inviting all of you forward. You'll be invited to take a piece of bread and a cup and drink it right there, and we have a tray at the end where you can put your empties in before you return to your seat. Now the bread is gluten, dairy, and egg-free. And we ask that you come forward, that if you can't come forward, just put your hand up and a deacon will serve you in the pew. Now this bread and juice is for the feast of God's tomorrow, when every tear will be wiped away, and all will gather at this table, at God's table, together. Come, you who long and labor for that day, for the feast is ready. Thank you. bread and life.
Friends, will you join me in our prayer of thanksgiving for our feast at God's table? Kind and gentle Jesus, we give you thanks for this bread and cup, this place and time. When the night is harsh and bitter, we still be found walking beside you.
As you challenge both power and pride,
help us to contemplate your courageous acts.
Bring us, despite our resistance,
to the foot of the cross,
and there may we learn to be merciful
in your name. Amen. Thank you.
When it was evening, he took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said, "Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another, "Surely, not I, Lord." He answered, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to the one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." Judas, who betrayed him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." He replied, "You have said so."
Then Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters because of me this night, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Though all become deserters because of you, I will never desert you." Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter said to him, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And so said all the disciples.
He came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down, and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him, and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial."
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is a man. arrest him and lead him away under guard. So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, Rabbi, and kissed him. And they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who drew near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them, Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled. All of them deserted him and fled.
Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, in whose house the scribes and the elders had gathered. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for false testimony against Jesus, so they might have him put to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last, two came forward and said, This fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days. The high priest stood up and said, Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you? But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him, I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God. Jesus said to him, You have said so. But I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, He has blasphemed. Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your verdict? They answered, He deserves death.
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, Are you the king of the Jews? He answered him, You say so. Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you. But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. A man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him.
When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by, watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last.